Thank you very much. Thank you, James, for this invitation. And I'm going straight to the point that brought us here. And I prepared this presentation with Kiko and Yvette here present, and we share this presentation in a couple of minutes. But what I want to tell you that I am an archaeologist. I am studying mainly the material culture of the people in the Fuegan Archipelago and Tierra del Fuego. And we are especially worried about the Selnam people of Tierra del Fuego, because at the end we will talk about the Caruquinca land owned by the park in that southern area, where originally these people, the Selnam, Foot Indian of Tierra del Fuego, lived before. The humans arrived to Tierra del Fuego about 10,500 years ago, before present, there. And the archaeology of the areas is quite well known, and we are going to speak about the historical period of what happened with these people in the historical period. But you have there a photograph of Charles Wellington Forlong of the in 1907 of the some of the hunters. This one there is named Pupup. It was trying to show the people how to do an arrow, yeah, in that photograph. Well, when the first explorer arrived, they didn't know if the island was an island, the Tierra del Fuego, because they passed just through the Strait of Magellan, and they cannot recognize in that period if it was a continent or an island. Then they called first Terra Incognita, and no land, or after Tierra del Fuego, because Ferdinand de Magellan, the sailor, saw some fires in this part of the Strait of Magellan. But the Selnam were important too because of and the Fuegan in general, because of the pass of Charles Darwin for that land. Charles Darwin was one of the first to describe the people of Tierra del Fuego, but he viewed them as hopelessly primitive, near to animal than humans, as he said. Yeah. He said also that the language of these people, hardly called an articulate language. One of the first Fuegan that went to Europe was the one depicted here, was Jemmy Button. Jemmy Button as a savage of Tierra, in Tierra del Fuego, and after that as a gentleman in England, in London, because they were took by Captain Fitzroy to London to be civilized. But in that time, when Jemmy Button returned immediately to his former, immediately became wild after 1 or 2 months, he was again like this picture here, like a savage. And Charles Darwin saw a kind of reverse evolution in this person. This is a lot of books about this person, these Fuegans, have been written about Jemmy Button, because of Darwin mainly. This is a map showing the human geography of this area. You can see the population, native population, different native population occupying this land from Chiloé Island in the north, or south of Chiloé Island in the north, to the Cape Horn here, covering, I don't know, probably 10 degrees of latitude. The people of this western land, this is a separated from the eastern part of Fuego Patagonia, as we call, by the Cordillera de los Andes here, that is running through this approximately here. And then you have the dry pampas to the east and the very wet channel to the west. And here the only way to live here is by a canoe. All the people here were canoe people. Yeah? And all the people here were foot Indians until the arrival of the horse in this area after 70, more or less. This is showing how they declined to by 1950, how they were, in fact, they were almost all the population here was killed, the Selna, as we shall see. And there are few survivals here in the present time. Following Darwin's observation, the Anglican missionaries were eager to Christianize the natives of Tierra del Fuego. One of the earliest they sent was Thomas Bridges, who founded the mission in what is now Ushuaia, Argentina, in 1873. He wrote, Bridges learned the Yamana language and wrote the Yamana English Dictionary, which contained 30,000 words demonstrating an unexpected sophistication against what Darwin said about the language of the Fuegians. This is the, one of the last Anglican missionary stations in Tequenica, near the Cabo de Hornos. This is another mission of ethnographic mission that was there, the Mission Scientifique du Cap Horn, from the French, a French expedition. And this is the horrible killing of, or from an explorer called Julius Popper. In the 1880s, a gold rush occurred in the north of Tierra del Fuego. And cheap ranches were begun. Bounty hunters were paid to eliminate the native, and the sheep outcompeted the native food source, the guanaco. European disease took the biggest toll of the people there. These are Popper's expedition photographs again. And this man is going to be very important to us because Lucas Bridges, the son of Thomas Bridges, grew up among the Yamana. And learned to speak the language. Later, he befriended the Selnam from the north. And we know he wrote a book about his life with called it The Uttermost Part of the Hurt, as you see there. And it's become an anthropological classic describing the life of the Selnam. Yeah? If you want to know about the Selnam, probably it's the best source to them. Lucas Bridges was the first white person permitted to witness the secret of the Selnam called the Hain. It was limited to man as an initiation ceremony into adulthood. Yeah. The women were tricked into believing they were God who they had to feed. Then it was a very, very machista. Do you say machista? Ceremonia or?
We use the Spanish word machista.
Yeah, okay. And the other person who was in Tierra del Fuego with the native in around 1907 was Charles, an American explorer, Charles Wellington Furlong. He took very beautiful photograph of the Selnam, like this one. They were living, surviving just in the south part of the island, in the forest, because the pampas in the north were, as he said, clear off of people there. This is the Salishan mission. In 1894, a Salishan mission was established in Dawson Island, opposite to the Tierra del Fuego. The men were separated from the women, and speaking their language was prohibited because they had to learn the Spanish, and the government said that. Disease like smallpox eventually killed nearly all of them because they were all together. Looking back to their Tierra del Fuego homeland, one told Bridges that longing is killing me. Longing is like nostalgia, no? Uh-huh. We know this was the map of the Wellington Furlong, and it's interesting because it's showing the last settlement of the people living in Tierra del Fuego. This area, as we shall see now, he's telling us formerly sickly people here, but now clear off. All the north was occupied by the farmlands, and the people go to the south and as a refuge, like the land that we will see in the next story of Kiko, the Karukinka land here, as a refuge. Oh, I don't know what happened with that one. The German anthropologist and Catholic priest Martin Gusinde was sent to Tierra del Fuego to study the Fuegians in order to fight against the anthropological evolutionist school. Yeah? According to him, and against the Darwin, God put the seed of himself even in the more savage souls of the herd. He was looking evidence of monotheism, monogamy, and private property among the Fuegian, as against the school of and evolutionist anthropologists that said that polytheism was in the origin of humanity. And he put a lot of attention to the spiritual life of the Selnam, then trying to make the relationship between religion, modern religion, and the oldest ones. Then the spiritual life is the very always depicted in a way for Martin Gusinde. Here are the spirits of the ceremony of the Jaind, the secret ceremony. Just to see the spirits. The mask and the body paintings. It was, and he was in the made a more accurate map of the Selnam territories. Wellington Furlong made that map of the territory, but Gusinde asked more detail of that. We were involved in a project trying to we discovered a source of raw material here, and we could trace the interchange of this raw material in the territory to see how this territory were working in the past, in the ecological past. This is a ceremonial hut of the Yamana Indians of the Beagle Channel. They have a similar ceremony than the Selnam, but they were canoe people. And these are the painting, body painting and face painting of the recorded by Alberto D'Agostini, another missionary, Catholic missionary in working in Tierra del Fuego about the 1920s. And following the clearing of the Selnam, the land was granted to a few private British companies associated with the local Chilean land laborers, barons. On the left are the first huge land grants. If you sum up to 1 degree of latitude wide, if you see this one, it's a very, very big territory for a company, a British company, in the Tierra del Fuego. on the right is the recent land ownership map. Yeah? The areas in green and brown will be bought in 1990 by the Bellingham Company, Trillium Corp. A 10 years battle ensued to try to protect the native forests from Trillium's logging plan. And this land was after that passed WCS. Yeah, Goldman Sachs. After that, WCS, and the land of the last Selnam here now is pertain to the Karukinka parkland that we are talking about now after this presentation of the Selnam. Kiko, it's your turn.
After what Teiko alluded to, the Trillium had their plans since they bought it in 1990, and then they went through a 10-year battle trying to get approval for a sustainable forestry plan that a local attorney here, Rand Jack, wrote up. But then after $1 million or so of EIS studies, it was shown that the regeneration rate at that latitude was so slow that they could only produce, on a sustainable yield basis, about 1,200 acres of trees per year out of their almost 800,000 acres of land. And so they couldn't find that profitable enough, and so they eventually defaulted to Goldman Sachs. And Goldman Sachs, a few years afterwards, in 2004, donated it to Wildlife Conservation Society. And they have the mandate to manage it on a for wildlife conservation purposes, and they named the park Karukinka, which is from the Selknam language for our land. And Barbara Saavedra is the director. She came about 3 or 4 years ago and gave a presentation here. Unfortunately, it's a little too far for her to come today. And so I just saw these slides about noon today. So I'm just gonna, hopefully Yvette and Teiko as well can just give commentary as we go through, and we'll tell you what we know of how they're managing the park now. It's this area that's in white pretty much. This must be a wintertime shot. It's all that area there. Diversity of landscapes, including the seacoast. And so they're also trying to get this Almirantasco, or Admiralty Inlet here, declared a marine sanctuary. And by the way, this map down here also shows where we're talking about. It's this area right in here, and this is the Admiralty Inlet. And Yvette's place is right there, just across the river to the south of where Karukinka Park now is. Right, this whole area right in here, 800,000 acres almost. Most of it is covered with this native forest, which Trillium had the intention of harvesting on a sustainable basis. It's a beautiful light-colored wood, sort of like our alder. They call it a beech. I'm not sure if it's really closely related to the beech, but there's big forests of it there that is actually the biggest extent of protected Linga forest in the world now. These are other, the whole southern tip, basically, not the whole, but a good percentage of the southern tip of South America is now preserved. These are huge national parks here, provincial park here in Argentina, that's the line between Chile and Argentina, a national park in Argentina, and both on the Chilean side as well. And that's Carquinca Park, which is private but managed as if it were a national park, basically. So I guess largest stands not of just Linga, but sub-Antarctic forests in general. There's not much other land at that latitude in the south at all. This is what it looks like on the forest floor. It's dense enough forest that the canopy closes the sunlight out from the undergrowth, and so it's pretty open. Generally, except where beavers have gotten introduced, invasive exotics from our part of the world, and they tend to raise the water table and make it, well, they drown out forests like this sometimes. We'll have shots of that. A lot of wetlands. Including what we call sphagnum, peat. And there was a danger of the peat being exploited because even though it's a private park, Chilean mining laws treated peat as if it were a mineral, and not even a private landowner could prevent companies from harvesting the peat. But I think they've gotten that law changed, right, Yvette, do you know? Yeah, so that's one of the things Carquinca kind of went to bat on and tried to get changed and succeeded. The wind is a very important element there that's almost ever present. And the northern part of Carquinca Park, and then going on north from there on Tierra del Fuego, is this more of a steppe-like open landscape. That's primarily where the Selknam lived. And as Teco said, this Carquinca Park was their last habitat before they went totally extinct. And this is looking west up this Admiralty Inlet that I pointed out, this here. And on this side is all Carquinca. And this is all D'Agostini National Park on that south side. Yvette's place is right here, called Caleta Maria. It's the only private land between this national park and Carquinca. This river here, Rio Aso Pardo, forms the boundary, the southern boundary of Carquinca. Teco was down summer before last, so about a year and a half ago, doing a archaeological dig on a shell midden right in here that was looking for evidence that the Selknam, who lived from here down below the screen to the right, this was as far as the Selknam went to the south, looking for evidence that they had contact with the Canoe Indians, the Kaweshkar, who inhabited the coastal zone in here. And we're going to continue, hopefully, that dig and others on shell middens elsewhere, still looking for that evidence. These are the predominant megafauna there. Pumas or cougars don't get onto the island of Tierra del Fuego. They go down to the southern tip of the continent. And these guanaco go onto the continent. So up on the continent, the puma prey on the guanaco. The guanaco was the main prey of the, or game of the Selknam Indians too. And this wonderful grass habitat is what caused the conflict in the 1880s onward from the sheep herders fencing off their land, trying to raise their sheep. The sheep competed with the guanaco for the forage, and the guanaco numbers plummeted, and that's one of the two or three main causes for the Selknam to have been eliminated, the other being diseases introduced by the Europeans from the 1880s on, and as Teco showed slides of the bounty hunters that the sheep herders hired for a period in the late 1800s. This is the largest carnivore, land carnivore, on Tierra del Fuego. Not very large. Not even big enough to keep the beavers in check, unfortunately. And the pumas don't get to the island either, so the beavers have no natural, predators. On the marine side, these are much bigger than guanaco or any other land megafauna. These are the elephant seals that occur. Just when I showed you that slide of Almirantasco or Admiralty Inlet, there's a colony of a couple dozen resident right there at the end of that bay, and then other colonies further out west. So they're part of Caruquinca Park now, and protecting them is part of their mission too. This is another part of their mission. This is looking across Admiralty Inlet to Caruquinca, all of this. And this black-browed albatross breeds on an island that's just off the picture here to the right. And another example of the threats posed by introduced species is that mink, introduced to Tierra del Fuego from North America as a potential fur-bearing species to harvest, escaped and are proliferating. And even though the island's about a mile offshore, the mink can swim over. And last year it was discovered that there was no generation, current generation, because the mink have eaten all the eggs. So that's another example of what Caruquinca wildlife biologists will be doing, is trying to get those mink eliminated, at least from the island. And then ultimately, Everyone would like to see them eliminated completely, as well as the beaver. But that's a big job. The condor is a native species there, and see them a lot. It's related to our pileated woodpecker. It's called the carpenter woodpecker. Lives on the linga trees, southernmost parakeet. You wouldn't think. You also wouldn't think you'd see flamingos down there, but there are. These, I think, are rockhoppers or macaroni penguins. Shows you the relative land masses of the northern and southern hemisphere, which really leads to some interesting differences in the wildlife. In the north, we have such great land mass that the diversity and the number of species is much greater. Down in the southern hemisphere, the ecosystems are just very restricted. There's just three species of trees, for example, in Karaukinka. That's how they harvest the peat, or harvested in Karaukinka even, until they got that law changed. I'll let mostly the pictures speak for themselves and kind of rush through the rest so we'll have time for questions and answers. Shows where the beaver were first introduced in the late 40s, spread that quickly to all parts of the island. In fact, well, there you see, they've somehow managed to swim across the Straits of Magellan, salt water, and gotten onto the continent. Hopefully, they can be nipped before they take over the continent, too. See how they raised the water level in here and drowned out the forests. This is part of the underwater maritime sanctuary they're trying to create. And they do things like attach beacons so they can monitor the courses of these different species. Also, salmon farming is big business up the coast to the north, and they're constantly trying to expand south because the colder waters make it easier to manage them. They don't have as many problems with diseases, but that would be another reason to try to keep them out of this bay at least. This is the bay where the elephant seals are resident. Tracking of a particular elephant seal named Jackson. That's Punta Amaria there. Coleta Maria is just to the left here. And the dig was right in here. Other big areas that are protected up to the north. And also Karukinka doesn't just protect the wildlife, they're trying to educate the locals. So they have a very active educational program and kind of like mountain school type, what we have here in the North Cascades Institute. They're trying to go that way as much as they can with the limited resources they have. Local identity, making the Wanako a mascot. And these are some of their materials, and that's what I was saying are on the table up here if you want to look at them afterwards. They've done some very nice work. Public school education. Vicuña is the headquarters right here, and the park entry is right about there. This is one of their several trails that they've developed. This is the logo that all their trails use, a Selknam logo. So go ahead, I can just keep flipping through slides and people can start asking questions of either of us.
What is the plan for eliminating the beavers and the minks?
Good question. Teiko, you take that one. Well, they reproduce really fast. For one thing, they're rodents, and so that's going to be a challenge. Traps, but that's manpower intensive. There are viruses people are looking into, but I don't think they've been approved. Do you know anything about this, John? I think in New Zealand they're experimenting with that. Some people flippantly maybe or seriously suggest introducing pumas to the Big Island. But who knows, that would probably unleash more problems than it would solve.
I can speak in Spanish, Juanita.
All right.
Es que el guanaco es un problema del país.
The guanaco is a problem of the whole country.
Yeah. Y para hacer algún plan oficial de erradicación.
You mean the beaver? She's talking about the beaver.
Yeah. Okay,
yes. We want more guanaco.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Para hacer un plan oficial serio de eliminación, se deben poner de acuerdo los dos países, Chile y Argentina.
To make a serious plan of eradication, there has to be a plan between Argentina and Chile.
Yeah, eso es lo más importante.
And the two governments are working on that together, but that's only very recently, and they have very limited resources. It's going to take a bigger effort than so far. Any other questions? Please? Yes?
So like here we have the American reservations and stuff like that, so I'm curious like how the histories of our indigenous populations are pretty similar. I'm wondering how
¿Entiendes? Como una comparación entre las reservas que tenemos aquí y lo que tienen en Chile.
Y el número de
población.
The number of people.
You mean native population or?
Yeah, the native people.
Native people, there are very few of them living now because mainly Canoe people living in the Western Channel. The Kaweska people are about 12, speaking the language still. And,
12 native language speakers of the Canoe people.
Yeah, and in the south, just one, the last one, is speaking the Yamana language.
And how old
I
is?
I think that here is very different because you have a very, very live native population, as I said.
Yeah, and Teiko is just speaking of the far south of Chile. In the central part of Chile, the Lake District, there's hundreds of thousands of Mapuche Indians, and they're very strong as a nation, you know, semi-independent, semi-autonomous. So it depends on which part of Chile. But down here, very few. Yes?
First, thank you both for taking us all on a fascinating journey to a place we probably won't ever get to go, any of us. There's so much going on here. I want to ask a question that's maybe prompting some things. It's going to pull some threads together.
Mm-hmm.
Let me try. And I want to riff off of your beaver comment that hopefully we can eradicate them from the whole continent before they take over. The whole presentation started with some inhabitants of the continent and the story of their dispossession and then ultimately fading away from the continent. In their place, we see people in kayaks and with hiking poles who are not of the place originally. And part of the story of those people leaving had to do with people from afar coming and putting in place on the land extraction resource programs, ranching and other things, along with which came the beaver. So now the project seems to be about protecting the landscape, bringing it back to some prior state. At the same time, we've just heard that there are virtually none of the original inhabitants left. So I guess my question becomes, this conservation project, for whom is it? And what are some of the justice and ethical kind of considerations that come out of that? And is really eradicating the beaver the central problem? Or is there a much larger issue of human geography, politics, and social justice going on?
Well, I'll say for sure that there's lots of problems. This is all very complicated. And who the park is being preserved for, I think you could say future generations of Chileans and other nationals as well. And as a laboratory for scientists, it's one of the largest intact ecosystems of that type left on the planet. So, if there were indigenous there, then it would be even more complicated, I'm sure, to decide how to manage it. There were those who suggested way before Trillium even bought the land that, you know, what's now Karukinka should have become a reserve. Like in the 20s or so, there still would have been time to have a viable population of Selknam living there. But we were a little too late now.
May I answer in Spanish?
Yeah, go for it, Teiko.
La gente que vive en la actualidad en Tierra del Fuego son descendientes también principalmente de los indios del centro de Chile. Así que es como una segunda población que arribó a Tierra del Fuego, porque los trabajadores de las estancias que se constituyeron en Tierra del Fuego son principalmente nativos de la isla de Chiloé, que son una parcialidad de los mapuches. Juan?
So what he's saying is that there are indigenous peoples there that are secondary indigenous peoples who migrated from Chiloé, primarily a very poor place. There was a Mapuche territory, and they migrated down there, and there are many of the laborers down there. So there are indigenous peoples, but not people from that were there originally. Okay.
Entonces el parque está tratando de reeducar en esa tierra a la segunda generación de indígenas que arribaron.
So they're trying to educate those people to become the stewards of the land as well. But your question is a really good one. How do you present in a park the understanding of the environment of people who are, for all intents and purposes, been decimated with very few speakers and a few descendants, but in the dozens, not in the hundreds even. So, so what do you do with a museum? What kind of interpretation do you? Yeah. And Yvette knows this because she deals with cultural memory. I don't know if you want to say something. Sí. ¿Quiere hablar un poquito? ¿Quieres hablar?
Sí, es el proceso de conocimiento de la etnia Selknam que fue eliminada, exterminada de Tierra del Fuego, es reciente.
Yes, so the whole attempt to put the thoughts or the conceptions of environment in place of the Selknam people is a really recent phenomenon.
Y hay ahora existe un creciente movimiento de traer a la memoria la cultura.
And so that's the attempt now. How do we reintroduce something that would be the memory and the sentiments, environmental sentiments and thoughts of people?
Y eso está haciendo un conjunto de profesores de historia, antropología, periodistas, ciencias sociales, de crear una, construir una memoria de ellos, tanto en la región como en Tierra del Fuego.
And that's why, so Yvette is part of the very first group of interdisciplinary group of anthropologists, sociologists, people that study history, environmental people. So at the University of Magellan, Universidad de Magallanes, that is doing that, which is part of the program right now, that includes some of the native peoples themselves.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. So it's 10 till. I want to just take a moment before we clap to thank our guests, and they're going to be here for a little longer, so you don't have to rush off, or you're interested, there's some material to the desk, and feel free to come down and talk more informally. So thank